Dear students, welcome to the UGC EPG Patashala on Human Rights and Duties. My name is Professor YSR Murthy. I am the Executive Director for the Center for Human Rights Studies, OP Jindal Global University. In the paper on International Fora for the Protection, Promotion and Enforcement of Human Rights, we take up today the module on Economic Social Council, or in short known as ECOSOC. At the end of the Second World War and chastened or deeply moved by the horrors of the Second World War in the context of genocide in Hitler's Germany, where there were concentration camps, gas chambers and millions of Jews perished. And the international community said, we shall not let these terrible human rights violations occur again. And it was in this context that the United Nations Charter was adopted, and it had several references to human rights. Right in the preamble, the importance of protecting the human rights and fundamental freedoms was recognized, and in the very first article of the United Nations Charter, the aims of the United Nations have been mentioned, and one of the aims is the protection and promotion of the human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without any distinction. And if you look at the UN Charter, the mandate of the various principal organs of the United Nations, like the General Assembly, the Economic Social Council, have been clearly mentioned. In fact, each of them have a series of functions which were enumerated in the United Nations Charter. And today, we are going to look at the Economic and Social Council in particular. What is its composition like? What are its functions, powers, and what have been its major achievements ever since its establishment till now, and what are the various drawbacks, and what are the unique mechanisms through which ECOSOC conducts its work? And we will take up these in detail today. At the end of this module, you will have an understanding of the mandate of the United Nations Economic Social Council in general, and in particular its functions relating to the protection and promotion of human rights. And what does the Charter of the United Nations say about ECOSOC? In fact, it was signed by 51 founding member states on 26 January 1946, and the UN Charter entered into force on 24 October 1946, and the ECOSOC is one of the six principal organs of the United Nations, with its headquarters based in New York. It addresses economic, social and cultural issues. Besides ECOSOC, the other principal organs of the United Nations are the General Assembly, the Security Council, and the International Court of Justice, and the UN Secretariat, and the Trusteeship Council. These together form the principal organs of the United Nations. And if you see the Article 55 of the United Nations Charter, the Economic and Social Council is responsible for promoting higher standards of living, full employment, and conditions of economic and social progress and development. Second, it is also responsible for solutions of international economic, social, health and related problems. And third and most important function is the one related to the human rights. ECOSOC shall be responsible for promoting universal respect for and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without distinction as to race, sex, language and religion. ECOSOC's mandate is based in the United Nations Charter itself, and if you look at chapter 10 of the UN Charter from article 61 to 72, they outline ECOSOC's composition, functions, powers and working procedures. And chapter 9 from article 55 to 60 confers further responsibilities which are directly relevant to human rights. By article 60, responsibility for the discharge of these functions is vested with the General Assembly, and under its authority in the Council. What does article 56 of the United Nations Charter say? It stipulates that all members of the United Nations pledge themselves to take joint and separate action in cooperation with the organization for the advancement of the purposes set forth in article 55. We have already seen the article 55 in detail. The ambit of such individual and joint action covers human rights issues under article 56 of the UN Charter. The mandate of the Economic and Social Council is quite broad, and it encompasses many of the United Nations system's key priorities. And the mandate of the ECOSOC under article 62 can be defined as follows. The Economic and Social Council make or initiate studies and reports with respect to international economic, social, cultural, educational, health and related matters. Some of these studies can be directly relevant to human rights issues, and based on the studies, ECOSOC can make recommendations. The ECOSOC can also make recommendation for the purpose of promoting respect for and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without distinctions. Three, it may prepare draft conventions for submission to the General Assembly with respect to various matters under its competence. Now, if you look at international human rights law, today we have over 70 binding conventions. Many of these conventions have passed through the ECOSOC. The ECOSOC may also call international conferences on matters falling within its competence. And in fact, it has been calling these conferences from time to time. And in short, UN Charter stipulates that Economic and Social Council shall make recommendations on human rights, draft conventions and call for conferences. All these have direct bearing or highly relevant for the purposes of human rights protection and promotion. Let us say what article 64 of the United Nations Charter says. It explains ECOSOC's mandate further in the following words, that Economic and Social Council may take appropriate steps to obtain regular reports from various specialized institutions, specialized agencies of the United Nations. It may make arrangements with the members of the United Nations and with the specialized agencies to obtain reports on the steps taken by them to give effect to its own recommendations, and also to recommendations on matters falling within its purview and within its competence made by the General Assembly. The ECOSOC may also communicate its observations on these reports to the UN General Assembly. Under Article 68 of the United Nations Charter, the mandate of the Economic and Social Council is explained as follows. The Economic and Social Council shall set up commissions in economic and social fields and for the promotion of human rights and fundamental freedoms and such other commissions as may be required for the performance of its functions. In pursuance of this, the ECOSOC established a number of commissions, including Commission on the Status of Women, Commission, let us say Human Rights Commission, and these have also done significant work in the field of human rights. Both of them were established in the year 1946. The Economic and Social Council's purpose within the United Nations framework has been laid out in the Chapter 10 of the UN Charter. For instance, Article 62 to 66, it is required to act as a mediator between UN entities on the one hand and as a forum for deliberations concerning the improvement of these entities' operations. ECOSOC further calls attention to pressing issues relating to economic and social development, health, education and culture by making policy recommendations to other UN bodies like the General Assembly, by initiating and conducting studies and by calling for international conferences. What is the ECOSOC's relationship with the General Assembly, which is another principal organ? It is mentioned in Article 13 of the United Nations Charter. It explains the relationship between these two organs. The General Assembly shall initiate studies and shall make recommendations for the purpose of 1. Promotion of international cooperation in the political field and encouraging the progressive development of international law, including international human rights law and its codification. B. Promoting international cooperation in the economic, social, cultural, educational and health fields and assisting in the realization of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without any distinctions as to race, sex and language or religion. The founders of the United Nations visualized an important role for the Economic and Social Council and gave it considerable powers in the UN Charter to make or initiate studies and reports and make recommendations to the UN General Assembly. Member states and the specialized agencies to prepare draft conventions for submission to the UN General Assembly and call for international conferences subject to the General Assembly's approval to enter into agreement with any of the specialized agencies. For instance, UNICEF is a specialized agency of the United Nations, and it is required to define the terms which the agency concerned should be brought into relationship with the United Nations to coordinate the activities of the specialized agencies through consultation with and recommendations to such agencies and through recommendations to the General Assembly and to the members of the United Nations. To furnish information to and upon request assist the Security Council as mentioned in Article 63 to the 66 of the UN Charter. Council has 54 member governments who are elected by the UN General Assembly. In fact, this is a much sought after body, and Article 61 of the Charter mentions that the Economic and Social Council shall consist of 54 members of the United Nations elected by the General Assembly and 18 members of the ECOSOC shall are elected each year and with for a term of 3 years and with 1/3 of them retiring every year, and a retiring member shall be eligible for immediate re-election. ECOSOC indirectly has purview over around 70% of the United Nations resources through its oversight of 14 specialized agencies and 13 functional and regional commissions. We will see what are these regional commissions in detail, and it is for these reasons Economic and Social Council's plenary's membership is highly sought after given the power, significance, central coordinating work of dozens of entities within the United Nations system. At present, Economic and Social Council have 9 functional commissions, many of which have definitely an impact on the human rights protection. Many of these functional commissions impact human rights, but in particular, if you look at the Commission for Social Development and then the Commission on the Status of Women and the Commission on Crime Prevention and Criminal Justice have played a prominent role in advancing human rights. Before 2006, there was a Commission on Human Rights. It was, in fact, it ceased its operation in that year, and it has been replaced by a Human Rights Council, and now the Human Rights Council is in existence and has been carrying on the work of the Human Rights Commission. These 5 regional economic commissions have been founded by ECOSOC, and the one in Europe called Economic Commission for Europe based in Geneva, and then there is a ESCAP, and it is Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific with its headquarters located in Bangkok. Then you have ECLA, Economic Commission for Latin America, located in Santiago, the capital of Chile. And then there is a regional commission called Economic Commission for Africa, based in Addis Ababa, and then you have a ECWA, Economic Commission for Western Asia, situated in Baghdad, the capital of Iraq. The ECOSOC has established a number of expert bodies composed of members serving in their personal capacity. They include, among others, Committee on Economic, Social and cultural right, which in fact oversees the international covenant on economic, social, cultural rights, and permanent forum on indigenous issues, both of which relate to human rights directly. The ECOSOC holds 1 4-week session every year in the month of July. Since 1998, it has also held a meeting each April with the finance ministers heading key committees of the World Bank, International Monetary Fund, IMF. What are the powers and functions of the Economic Social Council? ECOSOC is supposed to serve as the central forum for discussion of international economic, social issues of global or international or interdisciplinary nature and the formulation of policy recommendations addressed to member states, addressed to the United Nations, addressed to the UN system as a whole. And ECOSOC is expected to promote respect for and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all. ECOSOC shall make or initiate studies and reports and make recommendations on international issues, international economic, social and cultural, educational, health and related matters. It is required to call international conferences and prepare draft conventions for submission to the United Nations General Assembly on matters falling within its competence, and is required to make recommendations and to coordinate activities of various specialized agencies of the United Nations. It is expected to coordinate, rationalize, and to some extent program the activities of the UN and its autonomous organs and the specialized agencies in all of these sectors through consultation with and recommendations to the UN General Assembly and members of the United Nations. The ECOSOC is required to consult with non-governmental organizations concerned with matters falling within the Council's competence, and Article 71 of the UN Charter allows the ECOSOC to take consultation from NGOs in vague terms called suitable arrangements. Now, let us look up the ECOSOC resolution, which is mentioned in 1968, it allows the Council to establish three categories of consultations for NGOs. Now, let me turn our attention to ECOSOC resolution of 1235, adopted in the year 1967. And this resolution, a mechanism was created to allow discussion on human rights situations in all countries, and it was used to undermine the no power to take action or doctrine under this resolution. First procedure for examining human rights complaints was established. It provided a basis for public discussion and also examination of gross and systematic human rights violations in all states of the world. With this examination, the Commission was also empowered to make through studies of situations which reveal a consistent pattern of human rights violations, and to report these to the ECOSOC with relevant recommendations. This authorization to make studies provides the legal basis for appointing country-specific and thematic working groups and special rapporteurs. Today, we have nearly about 40 odd such special procedures mandate holders. It has proved to be the Commission's most effective remedies. The authorization to examine, however, does not cover individual cases but general situations of gross systematic human rights violations only. Now, here is another mechanism which has been provided in the ECOSOC resolution of 1503, which was initially adopted in 1970, but it was subsequently revised by a resolution in the year 2000. And what does this 1503 procedure involve? It takes up communications by victims or other persons or NGOs which are addressed to the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. These communications are basically in the nature of complaints, and in the UN terminology, these complaints or communications are handled under this 1503 procedure. The UN Secretariat eliminates manifestly ill-founded communications, and this is a confidential procedure. The adoption of this resolution leads to introduction of a confidential procedure for examining communications of concrete human rights violations. It was considered a big success, particularly by NGOs, as it opened up new ways of having their communications examined in a formal procedure, including those against states who have not ratified a human rights treaty. But with time, what happened was that the public procedure developed rapidly, and there were increasing possibilities to bring complaints of, you know, before this independent monitoring bodies. This strictly confidential, highly complicated and time consuming procedure lost much of its significance up until the year 2000. The 1503 procedure included the full subcommission and was even more complex and time consuming. What are the achievements of the Economic and Social Council? If you look at closely, between 1946 and 48, the ECOSOC took a number of key institutional decisions regarding human rights. As I mentioned earlier on, in 1946, it established two functional commissions, namely the Commission on Human Rights, which did a splendid work for about six decades and whose first priority was to elaborate an international bill of rights. ECOSOC has addressed a variety of other problems, including genocide, prevention of statelessness, discrimination, protection of minorities, the organization of the 1948 Conference on Freedom of Information, establishment of the Yearbook on Human Rights, and in cooperation with the International Labour Organization, ILO, the protection of the right to form trade unions and the prevention of forced labour. One of the most notable and important documents for the work of Economic and Social Council is the 2005 World Summit Outcome Document. This World Summit took place on 14 to 16 September 2005 in New York. It was the high level plenary meeting of the 60th session of the UN General Assembly, and it was a follow up meeting of the 2000 Millennium Summit. What happened in that outcome document? At this meeting, the concept of the responsibility to protect was discussed. This was an important doctrine in international human rights law. The World Summit outcome is also the fundamental basis for new mechanisms and concepts that concern ECOSOC, such as the Development Cooperation Forum and the Annual Ministerial Review. In conclusion, United Nations Charter has given a detailed mandate to the Economic and Social Council in relation to a number of matters concerning human rights. It can draft conventions, it can call for conferences, and it has evolved 1235 procedure, 1503 procedure. All of them had a great significance in the past several decades. Thank you.